is good with 0.3 seconds to go.
Davis launches a deep, deep three. What? Shot across the parking lot.
Heart of a lion. Fire inside me blaze like a siren.
Here's a pass down to the corner for the layup. Good.
Jesse ready.
There he's
another. Time is expiring. Blessed with tears. I conquer my fears. I'm ready to fly now.
Sally at the buzzer. Morris dribbles through traffic and takes it all the way to the rim for two.
Gives it over to Burrell. She nails it. You'll leave her open and she punishes you.
Happy Big Orange Game Day, everybody, and welcome to Countdown to Tip-Off, presented by UT Knoxville Alumni and Tennessee Athletics. Happy Game Day, and thank you for joining us for our virtual pep rally. I'm Brian Rice, UT alumnus and radio personality here in Knoxville. This event would not be possible without our partners and sponsors, including Coca-Cola, Farm Bureau, First Horizon, City, Graduate Knoxville, Graphic Creations, One River Walk, Pilot Company, Threads, and UT Medical Center. Before we get started with today's show, I want to send a special shout out to our alumni and friends in the Columbia, South Carolina Alumni Chapter. There are more than 800 UT Knoxville alumni who live in the Columbia area and fight the good fight in Gamecock country every day. So we know you're fired up for the Lady Vols in South Carolina tonight. Now let's get started. On today's show, we'll be joined by Chancellor Dondi Plowman. I'll have an interview with Lady Vol for Life and current ESPN analyst Andrea Carter. We'll have the keys to tonight's game and much more. Stay tuned. At the end of the show, we'll have our weekly prize giveaway as well. Right now, though, we get a message from UT Knoxville Chancellor Dondi Plowman.
Hi, Vols. I'm looking forward to cheering on our Lady Vols tonight as they take on South Carolina in the Thompson Bowling Arena. Our team has had quite an adventurous week after they were stranded in Texas due to the cold and icy weather. I am glad they're back home, home sweet home on Rocky Top, and ready for a great game. Tonight is also our annual Live Pink, Bleed Orange game, which brings attention to the fight against breast cancer and provides recognition to the courageous fighters and survivors of this disease. I hope you join me tonight as we root for our Lady Vols to victory. Stay safe and healthy. Go Lady Vols.
Thank you, Chancellor. Appreciate your message here today on Countdown to Tip-Off. Forgot to mention, a little later on, we'll also be joined by Tennessee assistant coach Lacey Goldwire as we get a little look inside their preparation for South Carolina. Right now, though, we go back to last year, February 2nd, 2020, as the Lady Vols went to Columbia to take on the Gamecocks.
Massengill will come into front court for Tennessee with a pass to Brown. Brown for the reverse layup, good by Lou Brown. Herbert Harrigan goes inside, right side. Good grief. Here's Massengill, dribbles right, drives in, hooks up the shot off the glass, good by Massengill. Off to Beal on the right wing. Beal goes into the paint, shot blocked out of bounds by Tamari Key. Davis comes top of the key to Burrell for a three-point shot and got it. Hit the rim three times and fell through. Tennessee needs a bucket, they're down eight. Here's Davis, right baseline, pulls up, 10-foot jumper, good. Here's Massengill. Massengill dribbles left, now puts one up from 15 and hits it. Massengill got three on the pick by Key. Skip pass over Grissett on the left wing. Now to Saxton, drives in, shot blocked by Key. That's five blocks for Key. Horston on the curl to Davis. Davis goes, steps back, eight-footer good. Here's Horston, gets the inbounds pass. In the right corner, Davis down to the baseline for the jumper, good by Davis. Off to Burrell. Burrell at the top of the key. Working against Herbert Harrigan. Fakes, then goes up and under. Scores. Nice move for Burrell. He has five. Now top of the key to Massengill. Massengill pulls up, shoots, and scores. Two-pointer for Massengill on the pull-up. Here's Massengill on the curl to Davis. Davis goes up and under. Beautiful move. Ree has eight. Dribble top of the key, over to Cook. Cook drives in, shot blocked again by Tamari Key. Here's a turnover by South Carolina. They threw it right to Key. Lead pass up to Horston. Horston drives, lays it up good. Here's Davis in front court, drives on Beal. Spins, doesn't shoot, goes to Brown. Brown for an 18-footer, good. Burrell drives on Harris, can't shoot, back to Davis. Davis shoots from 15, hits it. Goes to Burrell left side. Burrell drives, spins, puts up the follow-away shot, no good. Davis with a rebound, count it, she's fouled. Stutter steps, goes in, dumps it off to McCoy. McCoy puts it up, good. Burrell dribbles left, hands it off to Horston. Horston comes into the paint, puts up the shot, and got it. Here's Davis, drives right, puts it up, counted, she's fouled by Grissett. Your final score, South Carolina 69, Tennessee 48.
Our special guest today on Countdown to Tip-Off as we get ready for Tennessee and South Carolina, a Lady Vol legend who you see a lot of if you watch games on the SEC Network or ESPN, and that's Andrea Carter. Drea, you and I go way back to when you were a student athlete. Helped you write a couple of things that we'll actually talk about in a minute. But first of all, thanks so much for joining us, taking some of your time, because I know you're busy with TV and everything else.
Yeah, thank you so much. No, happy to be here with you all.
Your time at Tennessee, I don't want to say it's awkward because that's not the right word, but you committed to Tennessee with Pat Summitt. Mm-hmm. Pat obviously has the diagnosis with Alzheimer's. She's staying on for a year. Holly Warlick's coming in. You came in at a very transitional time. What was that time like in the program, a program that you'd wanted to play for your whole life?
Yeah, you know, it was really interesting because for me, being recruited by Pat, and obviously I had a great 4 years, I can't say enough about my time at Tennessee, but when I was recruited, it was really early. So I started talking to Pat as a freshman in high school, and then the other coach that recruited me, and who we have in our heart as well, Coach Deja Charles-Furlow, she recruited me as well. But when I got there, Pat was obviously there, but Deja wasn't there anymore at all. So for me, I didn't know Holly and Dean at all. And then obviously Coach Kyra and Coach Law were new. So, but for me, I had really only talked to Pat and I had only mostly talked to Coach Deidre. So it was a just brand new kind of staff. And I really getting to know Holly was my first year at Tennessee. I mean, I'd met her on trips and stuff like that. So it was very interesting because in a very transitional time in my life, obviously going to college from high school, and I was also just coming off of an ACL tear. And so like so many things were different for me going into college. And I feel like, you know, it was a transitional time for Tennessee as well. And so my first 4 years were Holly's first 4 years. And so there was a lot of fluidity and change and growth and growing pains as well. But I think that, you know, I wouldn't change it for the world because, I mean, the relationships that I have now, even if I didn't have them going in, I have them now and they're amazing. I just, you know, I saw Holly a few weeks ago, I guess it was, at the Charlotte studio. And she was calling a game and just, I mean, it was just great to see her. So yeah, it was awkward. I don't know what you would call it, but it happened and it was what it was. And looking back on it, it was great for me.
I remember when you had to make the decision that your basketball career was over. We sat in my office at UT and you ended up taking it and running with it. And I didn't do hardly anything with it, but to tell the story of, you know, how hard that was and why you were doing it. What do you remember about that time in your life where you've reached all these goals and you have another year, but your body just can't let you play the all out way you want to play anymore?
Yeah. You know, that time in my life was so hard. You know, I had lost Pat. I had lost my grandmother, who was my Nana was my world. And so and then I felt like I was losing basketball. So things that I like held on to very close, or that were very close to me and were just like gone. And so it was definitely hard. But for me, you know, even in the last couple of years playing, I had, you know, I had another knee procedure. I had a shoulder surgery. I missed a couple of off seasons, and I very much so committed to being that defensive player because that's what I could do, but I couldn't put the time in anymore. And I, looking back, I wish I would have put more time in, like, as a, you know, right after, before my knee procedure, or there's so many ifs or, but once I had that other knee procedure and just my body was just, it felt like it was just breaking down. So I wasn't getting in the gym extra. Some days I wasn't practicing. I was on the sidelines. I wasn't running sprints with the team. I was just doing what I could, but my game suffered. Defensively, it was fine. But for me, on the offensive end of the floor, getting reps was where I got my confidence. So now I'm not getting reps. I'm also not sometimes not getting reps in practice. And it was kind of just when I got to look at it, I was like, man, you know, I'm doing all of these incredible things off the court. I wish I could be this incredible on the court. Like, it got to the point where I was feeling like almost like I was a liability on the court. And that was a terrible feeling. And obviously, like, my teammates were amazing. Holly was amazing. The whole staff, like, I felt of value, but I didn't feel like I was reaching my potential. I didn't feel like I could ever become my best or be my best. I kind of just felt like what I was giving was the best that I could give, and it was the last that I could give. I just didn't think that I could handle another season mentally and emotionally of being in pain physically, and then just the mental wear and tear of not performing the way that you really want to, and not being able to train to perform the way you really want to. And so, you know, as an analyst now, I've called games where there is a player playing her fifth year and she's banged up and she's in pain. And I just commend them so much for doing that. But for me, I just felt like it was all that I could do. And I had an opportunity to finish my master's degree and focus on another career path that I could be my best in and not put my body through any more physical pain. And, you know, the doctors were just like, you know, do you want to walk when you're older? You need a knee replacement. And, you know, the chances of being a professional basketball player for long are probably slim to none. And so when I started weighing my options, it was just like, you know, I can put my health first, take care of my body, put my mental health first, and pursue something else. And so it was a really hard decision because I love playing basketball and I loved being in a Tennessee uniform, but I just eventually had to make it, and everyone understood and they were, you know, great about it, of course.
You mentioned that other career. It started, I guess, small, doing the SEC Plus games with Bob and with Roger and with everybody. And now people see you twice a week on the SEC Network or on ESPN. It doesn't matter if it's calling games or in the studio. What has that transition to a broadcasting career been like for you?
It's been incredible. I really can't say enough about the help that I've had along the way, because I didn't know I even wanted to do this. But even just as a player, Maria Taylor talking to me, Carolyn Peck, Kara Lawson, all the analysts that we had for our games, I formed relationships with them, LaChyna Robinson, and they, in the time where I was just starting out, even last year, my first time as a sideline reporter, I'm calling LaChyna. I'm talking to her, like, I'm asking so many questions. You mentioned Bob and Stacia and Tom and Roger, and they just helped me so much. Like, even the crew at the Thornton Center, who, that's where my grad assistantship was from, any game that I had, they were like, go. Caitlin Ryan's like, yes, go. Like, please do it. So just like the amount of support that I've had is, you know, I can't say enough about it. But honestly, it happened faster than I ever expected. The, you know, SEC Network and ESPN, they've been incredible at giving me opportunities. And so the only thing that I try to do is any opportunity that I have, I want to prepare the best that I can and perform the best that I can. And it just, yeah, it went from the ESPN Plus games. Coach Elzy calls me to do it, the Kentucky game. The game goes to overtime. It was against Mississippi State. That's when they had like Tierra McCowan and Victoria Vivians. And so if you weren't watching in the regular, you know, game, you started watching in overtime. And that's when I guess people were like, you know, who's calling this game? And everyone was like, it's Andrea Carter. And it just kind of like, it's a really long story, but it just flew from there. I got the next year, two TV games given to me originally. And basically my coordinating producer, who's awesome, she was like, you know, if you do well, I'll give you more. And so that's just how it was my first couple of years. I would start with a couple games, and then any that they sent me, I would just try to do well. And it's turned into studio, and I've done sideline reporting, and just, I wanna be like the Swiss Army knife for ESPN and the SEC Network for women's basketball. I just love covering the games and talking about the players, especially the SEC. Like when I talk about these programs and these coaches and these players, it's the best job. I mean, it's so much fun.
Last thing for you, and I'll get you out because we really value your time. Your number 14, another number 14, paces the sidelines for Tennessee right now, and that's Kelly Harper. In her second season, I know you see it as an analyst, the growth from year one to year two really seems like night and day in a lot of different facets of their game.
Yeah, I mean, just I really liked Kelly when I saw her at Missouri State. I was the analyst for their rounds against, they played Iowa State, and I remember that game, and I remember watching their practices and being like, man, she's really got all these players on the same page, and everything she says they listen to, and anything she told them, you know, she would pause practice and she'd be talking to them, and everybody was listening, everybody was tuned in. I just thought it was so cool. Like, I just remember being like, wow, they're motivated, they're inspired, and they are sticking to the game plan. And I just thought that was, like, as a first impression, I was kind of blown away by her. And just to see the growth that Tennessee, she clearly knows her players better. She's brought in players that are making a difference. And you know, I think that the transfers, Marta, and just everything, like, it's just moving in the right direction. And even if, you know, if you look at, I've been most impressed this season, the UConn loss, obviously, you know, that's a game that I feel like they had it. And closing games is something that programs have to learn to do it. Closing games isn't something you just know how to do, right? So that game obviously slipped away from them, but to come back and do what they did against Kentucky, right? Like, just the, I feel like that's a growth piece. And there are many other things that have happened this season, right? But just, there's definitely growth and togetherness and leadership. And I think the players, they look like they're having fun. So, I mean, I think that, you know, number 14 was a good pick. So,
Dre, we always appreciate some of your time here. Love watching you on the broadcast, and look forward to seeing you as this basketball season continues to hurtle towards, thankfully, having an NCAA tournament this year. I know we'll see you there.
100%. Thank you so much. Go Vols.
Andrea Carter, our guest today on. All right, let's get into our keys to the game as we thank Andrea Carter for joining us. You'll see her all season long and all postseason long on ESPN and the SEC Network. Our keys to the game tonight, well, it starts with number one, and I'm going to borrow one from football and from General Nealon's game maxims. Make the breaks, and when one comes your way, score. You're going up in South Carolina, one of the top defensive teams in the country. They feature the SEC's two leading shot blockers. There's going to be a lot of traffic in the paint. It's going to be difficult to score in the paint. So when you find a way to make a break, whether it's a steal, a fast break, whatever you can get, find your way to score. Number two, put on some pressure. As talented as South Carolina is, they have played two very close games their last two times out. An overtime loss to Connecticut last week, and then a close win over LSU this past Sunday. Come out, put on some pressure. Keep that a close game late. As Andrea Carter said, learn to close out some games. Be a lesson that Tennessee can try to apply tonight against South Carolina. And third is be consistent. The South Carolina team's unique in that they don't have one big gun that will get you. They have three players that average double figures. You can't lock down one. You have to be consistent and spread out among the three scorers. So to review, make the breaks. When one comes your way, score. Put on some pressure. Be consistent on defense. Those are the keys to a Lady Vol victory tonight against the South Carolina Gamecocks. Big Orange Country, the perfect subscription box now exists. It's a new year, so you need some new gear. There's a box for every season of the year for you to get your fresh new Volin gear. Each Big Orange box contains original pieces and collectibles only available from Tennessee Athletics. Choose your favorite season, including a basketball-themed March Madness box coming soon, the Vols of Summer, and Vol Tailgate. Or you can collect them all. Gift or get your Volin gear box now at allvols.com. As we get set for Tennessee and South Carolina tonight, somebody who's very happy to be back in Knoxville after an extended trip to Texas is Tennessee assistant Lacey Goldwire. She takes us inside the preparation for South Carolina and how her job as recruiting coordinator has changed up a little bit this year.
Hi, I'm Lacey Goldwire, the recruiting coordinator and assistant coach for the Lady Vols. Thank you so much for your support this season so far. It's been a crazy season, but we are thankful that we've been able to play as many games as we have. Things have looked differently in recruiting this year. I never thought I'd be recruiting so much virtually. Zoom has become a daily part of my life, and I think now that we've become a little bit more comfortable with it, we are really doing great things with it. We're bringing the University of Tennessee and Knoxville to student athletes around the country virtually, and they're able to see an inside look at our practices, our city, and our university over the computer. We've been focused on game prep for South Carolina this week. A few things that we've been focusing on: being physical and being competitive. I think with our size, our height, our strength, when we get rebounds and we take care of the ball, we have fun. And we are at our best when we're having fun. Not only are we looking forward to beating the Gamecocks, we are also celebrating our Live Pink, Bleed Orange initiative. This raises awareness for breast cancer research. It also honors fighters, survivors, and those who have fought to the end. We hope that you'll join us in the fight against breast cancer and the fight against the Gamecocks. Wear your pink, cheer loud, and bring the energy to Thompson Bowling Arena. Go Lady Vols.
Thanks, Lacey, for taking some time today on game day as we get set for Tennessee and South Carolina. You know, community service projects for Tennessee teams have been a little different in the world of COVID-19. Usual hospital visits and community outreach programs can't quite be the same, but it hasn't stopped the Lady Vols from giving back to the local community. Now let's hear on one way that Tennessee has impacted the community in this world of COVID-19.
I think that community service as a team is huge. It shows unity, it shows the community that just like they come together to support us, we're gonna come back together to support them.
Community service projects that my team participated in this summer was volunteering at the fish food pantry.
We've donated clothes to CARM. We've written little encouraging notes for their beds at night.
We got together after practice and we made sandwiches for the Salvation Army, and then afterwards we went to go drop them off, and that was able to have 2 days worth of food for those people and people at the Salvation Army.
My favorite community service project was volunteering at the fish food pantry because I got to meet several different people from all walks of life and just see the behind the scenes of how they work things at the fish food pantry. It was just really cool.
I think my favorite community service project was writing the encouraging notes. I obviously wish I could have seen, you know, the faces of the people who read them, but I just feel like positive words just go a long way. So no matter who they're directed at, you know, encouragement is big.
You know, being together during, like, well, making the sandwiches and stuff helps with our team bonding because we were able to, you know, laugh and joke and just have a good time while being able to help and serve others.
I mean, the community are the fans. They're the ones who keep this program going. So the least we could do is give back to them for, you know, all the support they've given to us over the years.
It's important for our team to participate in community service because it just continues to show us that it's bigger than basketball and that it's more than ourselves and that we can get outside of ourselves and help others and help the community that supports us.
Some great messages you saw there and some great opportunities for Tennessee to get in the community even when they can't get in to the community. Now let's hear from Associate Vice Chancellor of Alumni Affairs, Dwayne Wiles. We welcome him live here on Countdown to Tip Off. Dwayne, good afternoon to you. I hope you're staying warm over on campus.
Trying my best, Brian, and thank you so much. It's good to see you again. And Brian, let me start off. You know, I would be truly remiss if I didn't express how much we are thinking about our Vol family that is being affected by the unprecedented cold weather in the South. Our thoughts are with you and your families during this most difficult time. Now, before the big game tonight, let me share with our audience how they can be proud, be involved, and be invested in UT. Be proud by showing your big orange spirit and wearing your orange every Friday. Be sure to visit utvolshop.com for exclusive alumni merchandise. A portion of the proceeds from alumni merchandise in the Vol Shop goes to student scholarships. Be involved by helping us recruit future Vols through our Call a Vol, Write a Vol, and Recommend a Future Vol. You can learn more about these programs at alumni.utk.edu. And lastly, be invested in our students. We ask that you give at least one gift, any size, every year. You can choose from numerous donation funds so that your gift goes to a program that you want to support. To give today, visit us online at giving.utk.edu. Thanks for having me again today, Brian, and go Lady Vols.
Dwayne, thanks so much for taking some time this afternoon. Look forward to seeing you again soon. Before we wrap things up today, a big congratulations to our Lady Vols Fan of the Week, Verna Howard. We've got a prize pack coming your way. Do you want to win with our next events? Be sure you're following at 10 Alum. That's at T-E-N-N Alum on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram for how to win on all future drawings. Please be sure to join me again right here tomorrow as we count down to tip-off for Tennessee against Kentucky. On the men's side, I'll be live at 12:30. Streaming on Facebook and YouTube. And don't forget tonight's Lady Vols game, 7 o'clock on the SEC Network against South Carolina. Live pink, bleed orange. Even if you can't be in Thompson Bowling Arena, sport a little bit of that Lady Vol pink tonight as Tennessee takes on South Carolina. That's going to wrap things up for this edition of Countdown to Tip-Off. For all of us here at UT Knoxville Alumni and Countdown to Tip-Off, I'm Brian Rice. Go Lady Vols.